Hello everyone, I'm Bobby Galuba with OobaTech.com. It's Tuesday, October 13th, 2015, and welcome to my ninth video, recorded on Sunday, August 30th, 2015. In this video, I'm going to show you how to replace a noisy condenser fan motor in a Hotpoint refrigerator. So let's get started. Hello everyone, it's Sunday, August 30th, 2015, and here is my Hotpoint refrigerator. There it is. Several months ago, I'm not quite sure exactly how long, the condenser fan motor of the refrigerator started making noise, and it sounded like maybe it had something caught in it. I wasn't quite sure, but the sound gradually got worse and worse and worse until several weeks ago. It sounded like it was going really slow, and then it eventually just stopped altogether. So I had to order a new condenser fan motor, and today we're going to see how to install it. Okay, now here's a view of the sticker on the inside of my Hotpoint refrigerator, and this is what I use to find out the model number of the refrigerator. As you can see, it's an HTR17BBSERWW. Again, the model number is Hotel Tango Romeo 17 Bravo Bravo Sierra Echo Romeo Whiskey Whiskey. And so this is the model number that I used to look up the part that I needed, and the place I ordered it from was repairclinic.com. and I've ordered quite a few replacement parts for various appliances over the years from them, and I've had pretty good luck. And they also have videos for some of the repairs which show you how to do the repairs yourself. Okay, so if you're like me, you probably store a bunch of junk on top of your refrigerator. And as you can see on mine, I've removed everything. And that's what you want to do as well before you move the refrigerator, just so that nothing falls. And if yours looks like mine, it's probably got a bunch of dust on the top too. So take advantage of that time and clean off the dust too, which is what I'm going to do. So here's the top, and I've moved it away from its original position. It was in this little pocket here in the wall. And after the fan failed, the first thing I did was I put this little fan here to keep some air circulating around everything and keep it cool. I've got it off temporarily now just because it's noisy, but if your condenser fan motor ever fails, the first thing you want to do if you want to keep your refrigerator going is to put another fan in its place, just temporarily, to keep everything cool. Alright, here's the cover that I took off from the back of the refrigerator, and here's an example of what one of the screws looks like. If you see here, it's got a hex head and also a slot, so you can either use a nut driver or a regular flathead screwdriver to remove it. And here's what the threads look like. So again, this is an example of one of the screws that holds this cardboard cover on the back of the refrigerator. Okay, so let's take a look also at what it looks like down here. So this is what the back looks like. Here's the compressor, I believe, and here is the fan motor. And as you can see, I have it disconnected. It was plugged into here, but I've disconnected it just because I don't want it to sit there and be stuck and be burning up electricity and get too hot and possibly cause a fire. Okay, so we're going to try to take that fan motor out and put in a new one. Here's a little bit better view of the back here. Okay, so here's the box for the replacement motor that I got. And as you can see on here, the part number for the replacement condenser fan motor is WR60X10168. Again, that's Whiskey Romeo 60 X-ray 10168. Alright, so let's open up the box and take a look at that new condenser fan motor. Alright, so here it is. They've got a little piece of foam on here to protect the shaft of the motor. And as, if you notice, there is no fan blade on here, so I'm hoping that it's easy to remove the fan blade from the old motor and just push it onto this one. And another one thing about this motor, which is good, is that they already have the connector installed on the motor. Sometimes when you get replacement motors for things, all they have are free wires and no connector on the end, but this one has the connector, so that'll make it so that it's much easier to replace. And if you look here, let me get that in the camera, you'll see that it can only go together with the other connector one way. If you tried to turn it around, it wouldn't fit. So it's keyed, which means that the shape of the connector is such that it will only connect to its mating connector in one way. If you try to turn it around 180 degrees, you won't be able to push the two together. So let's take another look there. And the two positions on the left and the right, you'll see that they have a flat spot near the top, and they're rounded on the bottom. The one in the center is completely round. Another thing about this connector, let's see, and in fact I think on the mating connector, it has two tabs that grab on to these little teeth right here and lock it in place. So that's another good thing, in that it helps it so that the connector will not come loose. And you also see that the wires are color-coded, and we'll double check to make sure that the wires on the old motor are colored the same way. Now, if you notice, one of the wires is green, and I'm guessing that's probably the ground wire, because this is an AC powered motor. In fact, let's take a look at it here, and you can see that it is powered by 115 volts at 60 hertz, which is typical AC power in the United States. And it looks like it draws 0.193 amperes and 11 watts of power. And it runs at 2200 RPM, or revolutions per minute. And I believe it'll, I'm guessing that indicates that it'll heat up to about 40 degrees Celsius. So that's kind of hot, but not too blazingly hot. All right, and it looks like it was probably, I'm guessing, it was made in China. All right, so this is the replacement motor. And I believe this is a coil of wire also under here. And it's kind of like you would see, kind of like the assembly of a transformer. And you can see these plates, and those plates, if I'm correct, they help to reduce the effect of eddy currents that would be induced in the plates. So each one of these plates are stacked together, and they're insulated from each other. And so that helps to reduce the eddy currents. Alright, so let's take a look at the back of the motor, and again, you can see the green wire, and yeah, I'm pretty certain that this is the ground wire because it's connected to kind of the main metal body of the motor. Okay, so here we go. Here's the replacement motor. It spins freely. So let's go ahead and we'll get the old motor out of the refrigerator. Okay, so as another safety measure, in addition to taking everything off the top of the refrigerator, we also want to unplug the refrigerator from the AC or alternating current outlet in the wall. So let's go ahead and we'll do that now. Let's pull it out right there. Alright, and if you see down here, here's the little middle connection right here. That's where the ground wire ultimately connects to, and then that goes through the wiring of the house, and it should be connected to a rod that actually goes down into the soil or ground and provides a connection to earth, and that provides a little margin of safety. And the reason why you want to have a ground connection is, say for example, you've got an appliance and maybe one of the wires maybe the insulation of one of the wires wears through and it contacts the frame of the appliance, well, the frame itself should be grounded, and that should cause that electricity to go into this wire and then into the earth, basically, and it prevents people from being shocked. Okay, so again, we want to unplug the refrigerator from the wall before we do any of the repairs. Now, to do this repair, you'll need a set of sockets and a nut driver. And here is my set of sockets that I like to use. And this is a set of sockets that's kind of set of sockets and wrenches that's kind of different than most that you'll see. This is by a company called Metrinch. It's Metrinch. And this is a tool set that I bought many years ago. I'm not even sure if they're still available. But if they are still available, I highly recommend that you get a set. And the reason why is that instead of being like a typical wrench and socket set where you would have, say, like this, which is a 12-point wrench. This is a box end of the wrench. Instead of having a 12-point box end, or say this one here, actually, nope. This one here, which is a 6-point socket. See, notice the hexagonal shape. Instead of having just a 12-point or a 6-point profile, which you can only use on either metric or standard, you can't use them on both. So, like in these types, their size for only metric or for only standard. But with the Metrinch set, let me show you the profile of one of those wrenches. It has this lobed profile, and what this lobe profile allows you to do is use the tool with both metric or standard nuts or bolts. And also another advantage of this lobe profile is that if you have a nut or a bolt which is rounded on its corners, you know, maybe by someone using an improper tool or it just being on there too tight and somebody trying to turn it in the metal of the fastener kind of giving way and wearing off, you can use this type of wrench to turn nuts or bolts that have been rounded off. Okay, so because basically these, instead of pushing on the very corners of the nut or the bolt, it pushes more on the face of the nut or the bolt. Okay, now these 6-point ones, they're fairly good for that too, but I don't think they work quite as well as these. And a 12-point one doesn't work really well at all if you have a bolt or a nut that's rounded off. So again, this Metrinch set, because of its lobed profile of its wrenches, here's the open end of the wrench, and also let me show you one of the sockets. It also has that lobe profile. This one's kind of rusty, but you can still see those lobes in there. And if you'll notice, here's the name, Metrinch, Metrinch. It has sizes in both standard, this one is 5/16 of an inch, and metric. So it's 5/16 of an inch and 8 millimeters. So it can work with both 5/16 of an inch nuts or bolts and 8 millimeter nuts or bolts. Okay, so basically you have two tool sets in one that can be used with both metric and standard nuts and bolts. Okay, so if you don't have a set of Metrinch tools, I highly suggest that you get a set if they're still available. And for this repair, I checked, and it looks like for the screws that are used to hold the cardboard cover on the back. Again, notice that they're hexagonal, so you can use a socket with a nut driver or a flathead screwdriver, and this particular one fits into this socket, and it is the 1/4 inch socket. All right, and the ones that hold the condenser fan motor to its mount, that's this size. I just checked, it's a 5/16 size socket, and I believe, since this is an American made refrigerator, I believe it's American made, I believe all of the fasteners on there should be standard. If you only have a standard socket and wrench set, I don't think you'll need a metric socket and wrench set. Okay, so here's the 5/16 of an inch socket that I'll use, and then when I go to put the cardboard cover back on, I will screw those screws in with a 1/4 inch socket. Okay, and again, here's that lobed profile of the Metrinch tool set that works with both metric and standard nuts and bolts. Okay, so let's go ahead and we'll see what needs to be done to take that old motor out. Okay, when I initially took the cardboard cover off the back of the refrigerator, it was completely covered in dust. It had all sorts of gobs of dust in there. So one thing you'll need to do is probably have a good shop vac to clean off all of the dust that will probably have built up over the years in the back of your refrigerator. All right. Now, I did a little poking around. Here's the motor. I've also reconnected the power connection for the motor so that you can see how it goes together, and we'll disconnect that in a little bit. And the AC power is disconnected from the wall, so it's not trying to run the motor at all. Here's the motor. All right, here's the fan blade, and I also did a little tinkering around with this fan blade, and I noticed that the tips of the blades are kind of worn down. If you see, they look a little raggedy here, and it looks like they were rubbing right here on the edge of this metal fan shroud. Okay, so I think because the motor is so old, the bearings of the motor had worn down and have a lot of play. And let's shake this, and as you can see, let's get in there a little bit better. You can kind of see that it's pretty loose in there. You can move it up and down, and also let's see if we can move it in and out. Yeah, so it moves in and out fairly easily. And we'll check that on the new motor, but I don't think the new motor has anywhere near that much play. And also, I noticed this little collar that's on there. So we may have to try to remove this collar somehow. I'm not quite sure how to get it off, but what I'll try to do is just pull it off the shaft, because I don't think the shaft isn't keyed at all. And doesn't screw on the shaft, so I think we may just be able to pull that off. But again, it looks like because this motor is so old, the bearings in there are probably really worn out, and that allowed a lot of play or movement in the shaft of the motor, and so that caused the tips of the fan blades here to scrape along the edge of the fan shroud, and that's the noise that I was hearing when it was starting to make a lot of racket. Okay, so now also here is the one of the nuts that'll need to be taken off, and again, these you want to turn them counterclockwise or lefty-loosey, so always remember the phrase lefty-loosey to take off most fasteners, most nuts, and most bolts, and righty-tighty, you turn it clockwise to tighten most nuts and bolts. And now there are some exceptions to that rule, but in general, lefty-loosey to
loosen them or remove a nut or a bolt, and righty-tighty to tighten a nut or a bolt. Okay, so there's one of them that we'll need to remove. And let's see if we can get a view of the other one. And the other one, let's see, is right there where my finger is. And so we'll take both of those off. And I'm hoping that I can just pull this fan blade off. All right, in fact, let's see if I can just push it off now. Yeah, so that feels like it's coming off fairly easily. Let's push a little bit more. Yep, there we go. Okay, so that fan blade is off. And once I get the motor out, I'll take the fan blade out the rest of the way. So that was fairly easy to push off. And you can see the little pan down there, which catches some of the water. And later what I'll do is also little fins of the, I believe that's the condenser coil down there. I won't be able to do it tonight, but I'll have to vacuum that out as well so that the refrigerator will work more efficiently, because that's what exchanges the heat. And basically it takes the heat from the inside of the refrigerator and the freezer, brings it to these coils right here. The refrigerant condenses, releases its heat into the air, and that's how the refrigerator is cooled. But if those fins are covered by a bunch of dust, it's not going to be able to exchange its heat as well and operate as efficiently. Okay, so here's another good view of the back of the refrigerator. All right, and actually here's a little drain tube that you can see as well, and the little pan that it drains into. And that water just evaporates. You don't have to, you know, empty it every time. It just evaporates on its own, I believe. So, all right, so let's get the socket to take off this nut, or excuse me, this bolt, and this one in here. Okay, here's another safety tip that I just thought of, and it has to do with these screws that hold the cardboard cover on the back. Once you take these off, you want to make sure you pick them up off the floor if you set them down on the floor, because if you notice, they're very pointy, and if one of these things is sticking up and somebody walks into the kitchen, they may step on these and get a bad surprise. So make sure you put these away right away. Once you take them out, put them in like an old jar or something, or put them on top of the counter so that nobody steps on them. Okay, so I have my nut driver here for my metrinch set. Okay, and I've got my 5/16. Hopefully you can see that there. I can't really see it in the camera myself. But here is my 5/16 inch socket, and I'll go ahead and I'll put it on the end of the nut driver. If you notice, the nut driver has a square end, and it also has this little spring-loaded ball on the end of it, and that helps to lock the socket onto the end of the nut driver so it doesn't fall off when you're using it. And if you see the socket, this is the end of the socket that goes onto the nut driver, and it has a square hole that the nut driver goes into, and it's probably maybe a little difficult to see here. Well, actually, I don't think this one has any grooves for that little ball to go in. I think it just squeezes against the side, but the ball basically squeezes against the inside of this socket and helps to keep it from falling off the end of the nut driver when you're holding it upside down. So that's what it looks like when it's connected together. And we'll use this to remove this bolt and the bolt in here, which hold the motor mount in place. And also, before we do that, here's the connector. And if you'll see, there's these two tabs on either side of the connector. And what I'll do to disconnect the connector is I'll squeeze these together first. That releases the tabs from the teeth on the connector that goes to the motor, and we'll just pull them apart. And again, like I was saying, the ends of the connectors are keyed so that they can only go together one way. They can only go together this way, okay? But if I disconnect it and I try to rotate the connector of the motor 180 degrees, I can't get them to go together because they don't fit that way. It's because they're keyed. So again, I'd have to turn it back 180 degrees and then I could reconnect it. And if you notice, these tabs lock into place over the teeth on the connector for the motor. Okay, so let's squeeze the tabs again on the opposite ends and then just pull it apart. Okay, so the motor's disconnected from the wiring harness, and then let's take these bolts out. And remember, let's turn them counterclockwise or lefty-loosey. Alright, so we've got one of them out of there. And let's see if I can get the other one out. Try to hold the motor at the same time. Okay. Get it out of there the rest of the way by hand. Okay. All right, and the little bracket comes off the back. And here's a view of that. Here's the outside view. Here's what it looks like on the inside. And the end of the motor just fits into that hole right there. And it holds it in place. Okay, so let's take the motor out. Okay, so here's the motor, and if you see, it's all crammed with dust, and that's what most of the back of my refrigerator look like. And I'll have to make sure to clean later on once I get a chance. I'll have to make sure to clean all the dust out of the condenser coils as well. Let's take a look at the shaft of the motor, and as you can see, it's got a bit of play in there, and that looks like that's probably not supposed to be there. And let's see, it moves back and forth, and so you can tell it's pretty worn in there. You can still rotate it, but it doesn't move nice and smooth really like the other motor. And when as a temporary fix, what I had tried to do is just kind of quickly spray some oil in there when it stopped. I wanted to see if I could get it going because it failed right before I had to go to work, and that didn't really work. But it probably would be a lot noisier if I had not sprayed some of that oil on there. So again, here's the old motor. There's the shaft for it, and here's what the back looks like, and here's the wires. Again, it has a black wire, an orange wire, and a green ground wire. Okay, and there's the keyed connector. Okay, so we've got the motor out, and let's take the fan blade out. The fan, I should say. Okay, so here's the fan, and I'll wash that. Here's the side that connects to the shaft of the motor. All right, and here's what the other side looks like. And so I'll go ahead and I'll clean that up in the sink before I reinstall it. And also, if you can see here are the edges, and you can see that they're kind of worn down. I'm going to still use this fan blade. I think it'll still work fine, but if you notice, it's they're definitely worn down, and that looks like they were worn down because of the play in the bearings of the motor, allowing the fan to move off center and make contact with the fan shroud. Okay, so here's the fan after I've cleaned it up, and
if your kitchen is like mine, you probably do frying of foods in your kitchen. And when you fry foods, little particles of grease go all over the place, and they'll get into all the nooks and crannies of your things in your kitchen. And on this fan was a nice coating of grease and dust. So I used some dish soap to cut the grease, an old toothbrush. If you don't save your old toothbrushes, now's a good time to start saving them, because they are really good for cleaning up old parts, old dirty parts. And I also used my grody looking fingernail here on my thumb. It looks pretty gross, but man, it is really a good tool for scraping stuff off dirty parts. So here's the fan again, and here's the ends of the blades, which you can see had been wearing against the fan shroud. All right, and here's the point that mounts to the condenser fan motor. Okay, and then here is the bracket that holds the back of the motor in place, and I clean that up as well. All right. Now, another thing that I noticed on the motor, on the old motor itself, is that it has these two rubber bushings. And so what I'm going to do is I'm going to take these off. They're a little hard, but I think they'll probably still be usable. These, I think, are used to, you know, not only hold the motor in place in its mounting brackets, but also to help deaden or quiet some of the sound that would normally be produced by the motor vibrating in the motor or in the brackets that hold the motor. So I'm going to go ahead and let's twist those off. Here's what they look like up close. All right. And I'm going to clean those up. Take one off. I'll take the other off, the rear. And let's compare the two, see if they look the same. And I'd say, yeah, they look pretty much the same. In fact, it looks like maybe the part numbers are a little bit different, so we'll keep them separate. But here's basically what they look like. Okay, so we'll clean those up, and then we'll put those on the new motor. Now let's also compare the new motor to the old motor. If you see here, I'm trying to move the shaft of the new motor up and down, and I can move it in and out just a little bit. It does have some play in and out, but up and down, I don't feel any play at all. Okay, so this is the new motor. Now here is the old motor that we just took out. And if you see here, you can definitely see some play in that, and the shaft moves in and out a lot more as well. And let's see here, let's look at the ends. And the ends you can't really tell, because you can't really see the bearings and this tip of the case that doesn't actually contact the shaft. I think there's probably some bushings inside there. I doubt they have any ball bearings in there. I doubt they're that good of quality. There's probably just some bushings in there. Okay, so again, notice the play in the shaft of the old motor versus no play in the shaft of the new motor. So this was really the main source of our problem. This shaft was moving up and down. Actually, it dropped down and allowed the blades of the fan to make contact with the fan shroud, and that's what was causing all the noise. And then eventually the motor seized up anyways, and it wouldn't rotate. Okay, so let's go ahead and I'll clean up these bushings and I'll put them on the replacement motor. Okay, so I've cleaned up the little bushings or motor mounts for the motor with my old toothbrush, my fingernail, and some dish soap. Got those cleaned up, and I'm going to put them on the new motor. Now, one thing I also noticed is that if you see here, there's kind of an indentation on the bottom here, but no indentation on the top. So what I'm going to do so that hopefully the motor will ride a little bit higher and be less likely to hit the fan shroud is I'm going to orient the indentation towards the top. Okay, and the motor, the way it'll sit in the brackets is that this will hang down, and so I'll put this bushing or motor mount on this end and have the indentation near the top and have this flat spot near the bottom. Okay, and then I'll do the same thing for the other one. If you notice, it also, let's turn it around, it has an indentation here and a relatively flat surface on the opposite side. So I'll orient it so that the indentation is towards the top, and hopefully that will make it so that the motor rides, sits a little bit higher in the brackets that it's mounted into. Okay, so notice this indentation is on the top here. Okay, and this indentation is on the top, on the back of the motor as well. Now, I'm not going to put the fan on the shaft yet, because I have to mount the motor in the bracket that holds the front of the motor first. Actually, I'll have to put the fan behind the bracket, mount this, or put the shaft through the hole of the bracket that the front of the motor mounts to. Then I'll have to push the fan onto the end of the shaft, and I'll also I'll put this bracket on the back and bolt it in place, and it will it fits over that little bushing or motor mount that goes on the back of the motor, and there's a corresponding one that goes over the front here. Okay, so let's go ahead and mount that in the refrigerator. Okay, so now I'm ready to install the new motor. I have the two bolts that hold the rear bracket to the front bracket. I have the new motor with the rubber motor mounts or bushings installed. Here's the one on the rear and the one on the front. Okay. And I have the rear bracket here, which I will use to hold the motor in there, and it'll be bolted to the front bracket. Okay, so what I'm going to do, and I also have the fan. Okay, another thing to remember, which you may not realize when you're doing this repair if you get distracted, is you want to make sure that you do all of this repair all at once if possible, in one day, or you know, as quickly as you can, because while you have the refrigerator unplugged, remember, it's not cooling, keeping your food cold. It will stay cool for quite a while, but you don't want to, you know, start the repair and then continue it a few days later with your refrigerator unplugged, because all your food will thaw out and go bad in your refrigerator. Okay, so let's position the fan in the front here, and we'll push the motor through the front bracket. Let's see here, I'll have to hold the motor with my right hand here. What I'm going to do is I will push the fan onto the shaft. There we go, that went on there fairly easily. And let's see if it's positioned. Well, we may have to, yeah, I think we'll have to wait to try it out once we get the, we'll have to wait till we put the rear bracket on there. Okay,
before we test it. Now let's see here. Let's try now that I've got the connector out of the way. Okay, so if you see here, it spins fairly freely, nice and smooth. Okay, and it's not hitting the fan shroud. All right, so let's go ahead and we'll take the rear bracket and we'll bolt it in place. Now put it on the back of the motor here, line it up, and I have my 5/16 inch socket here, my metrinch socket. It's the 5/16 inch one with the little lobes that I was telling you about. And what I'll do first, though, is before I use that nut driver, is I will put the bolts in. I'll try to screw them in by hand at first. It's always best to put bolts in and screws by hand at first if you can, to avoid cross-threading them. If you cross-thread them, that basically means that the threads are kind of cutting into each other and they're not aligned properly and they can damage each other. So let's see if I can do that by hand. Let's get the holes lined up. Okay. All right, so I've got this one started by hand with my fingers. And you're never going to be able to apply enough force with your fingers to cross-thread it. It'll just feel like it's not going in properly. All right, so we'll screw it in most of the way. All right, I don't want to screw it in all the way because I want to be able to move the other side, the opposite side, still, so that I can line up the holes on the opposite side. Okay, so let's see if I can get that in there. A little awkward. Let me reposition myself. Let's see, it's lined up there. Okay, there we go. And get this second bolt started. Try to screw it in quite a bit with your fingers so that you don't cross thread it, and then you can screw it in the rest of the way with your nut driver. Okay, and just hand tighten it. You don't have to have a certain amount of, you don't have to have a torque wrench or anything to tighten this, just hand tighten it. Don't do it too much because you don't want to strip the threads, but just use a reasonable amount of torque to tighten them and hold them in place. Okay, so I think that's good. And again, the motor, the wire end is hanging down. All right, I've got the connector here. I'll connect them together, and remember they're keyed. And the two tabs, the tab on the left and the tab on the right here, will lock into place over the two teeth that are on the connector, which is on the motor. All right, so now let's just spin the fan. All right, it spins nice and freely. I don't hear it hitting the fan shroud. We'll check the play again. Notice it doesn't really move much up and down. I think the movement that is there is because of the little the bracket of this mounting system is kind of loose here. There is some flexibility here, but not enough to allow it to hit the fan shroud. Okay, so and the bearings in there are nice and tight. They do allow the fan to spin, but they don't allow the shaft for the fan to move up and down. Okay. All right, so let's go ahead and plug it in. I'll plug it into the wall. Okay, so there we go. The fan is spinning. It's not hitting the fan shroud. Don't hear any unusual noises. I do hear the hum of the fan, but it sounds pretty good. It's not making any excessive noise either. I was a little worried that it might be out of balance because it would, the tips of the blades had ground down a little bit, but I think it'll be all right. And so there we go. It's a good repair. And that should keep the compressor nice and cool and help to cool the fins of the condenser as well. All right, so let's get the cardboard cover and we'll put that on. All right, if you notice, the cardboard cover has these slots in it. And I'll clean those off a little bit better before I mount it. Okay, so now I'm ready to mount the cardboard cover on the back, but before I do that, I just wanted to show you that the motor, I wasn't sure exactly which way it was turning, so what I did was I just took the two connectors right here, and I disconnected them, and you can see that the motor and the fan turn clockwise when viewed from behind, and so it's blowing air out the back. Okay, it basically sucks it in from underneath through the condenser coils and then blows it out the back, and the motor and the fan spin clockwise. So let's go ahead and we'll reconnect that. And there it goes, it's starting up again. Make sure the connector is firmly plugged in. Make sure the connectors are firmly plugged into each other. And then what I'll do is I'll put this cover on the back. Now, this cover, I believe, is supposed to have, let's see, one, two, three, oh, okay, four screws. So I think I have all the screws. At first, I thought I had missed some because I was kind of in a hurry to when I initially took this off. And I thought I had possibly lost some of the screws, but I think I have all of them. So I've got the four screws right here. Okay. And I have my 1/4 inch. Let's see if we can see that there. My 1/4 inch metrinch nut driver with and socket. Okay, so I'll start these screws in by hand so that I don't cross thread them. And these aren't too big of a deal if you cross thread them anyways, because they're self-tapping screws, which means that when they're initially installed, they cut their own threads. So let's put one in the top here. And remember, righty-tighty to tighten them up. And these you definitely don't want to put too much torque on, because these types of screws are easy to strip the threads. So we'll just kind of lightly screw those in. Put one on the right side here in the back. And it's not a big deal if they're kind of crooked. This one I think was installed crooked, so that's the way it's going in, is crooked. But that's not a big deal though. As long as it just holds the cardboard cover in place, that's all you really need. Okay. Let's put the other two on. This one here, looks like the cardboard cover's a little ripped, so that's not a big deal. Let's see if it's lined up at that hole. Put the hole there. No, let's see where that is. See if we can find that hole there. Okay, it's just up a little bit, so we'll have to move this up a bit. In fact, let's loosen these two up a bit so we can reposition the cardboard cover a little bit. Okay, I just loosened those two up just a bit so I can rotate this up, line up the holes. And this one I want to make sure I don't drop because it'll go behind the cover. All right, screw it the rest of the way in place. Just leave it a little loose until I get the last one in position. Okay, got the holes lined up. And righty-tighty to screw in the last one. And then we'll tighten them down the final amount. And remember, don't tighten them too much. And righty-tighty to tighten them, or clockwise, turn them clockwise. And if you don't have a nut driver, you can also use a flathead screwdriver, but you will need a nut driver or a wrench to remove and reinstall the bolts which hold the mounting brackets together. Okay, so there we go. We've got the cover on, the new fan motors installed, the fan spinning freely, and it's pumping out a good amount of air. All I have to do later on is to clean the fins of the condenser so that there's no dust in there and it works more efficiently. And now you see how to replace the condenser fan motor on a Hotpoint refrigerator.
All right, so I've moved my Hotpoint refrigerator back into position. And it's humming along nicely with the condenser fan motor spinning and pumping out air and cooling everything. Now, what I'll do tomorrow is take my my air compressor and use it to, I'll blow underneath the refrigerator and try to clean out those fins. I'll also probably pull it out again so that I can vacuum all the dust up and blow out the fins from the back again as well. But when you do this type of repair, you want to make sure that you clean the dust from those fins. Otherwise, you're not going to be doing a complete repair and the refrigerator won't operate as efficiently and it'll use more electricity. Okay. Now, another tip that I thought of while I was moving the refrigerator back into position is that before you move it out of position the first time, what you want to do is make sure you take out any bottle, like glass bottles or fragile stuff, or things that may spill, that may easily topple over before you move it. And if you've got a nice smooth floor, it's not really a big deal, but if you have a tile floor like I do, which mine needs to be cleaned badly, when you roll the refrigerator over the grout lines, the wheels of the refrigerator are small and they're also very hard, so it's going to be difficult to get the refrigerator to go over the grout lines, and so you're going to have to kind of jerk the refrigerator around a little bit, and that's going to kind of shake things up inside. So before you move it, you want to take everything out that may easily tip in the refrigerator or things that may be fragile. All right, so thanks for watching, everybody, and I hope you learned something.